This is the fourth part of our series on targeting vision applications to FPGA or ASIC hardware. The previous video outlined some specific hardware implementation decisions made for the lane detection design, and this video will focus on the actual implementation. Typically, once you have designed your implementation and verified it against your golden reference, you would quantize it to the smallest data types that get you sufficient accuracy. Hdl Coder can synthesize single precision floating point types, but for most digital hardware, fixed point types will reduce resource usage. The challenge is always balancing this versus enough accuracy. The Fixed Point Designer tool walks you through the process, but for designs that use the Vision HDL Toolbox gateways, it isn't always necessary. One of the really nice aspects of Xilinx is being able to visualize data types as they move through the data path. The pixel data coming out of the gateway block here is an unsigned 8-bit integer, and as Xilinx propagates it through the data path, it ends up coming out of the image filter as a signed 24-bit word data length, with 15 of those bits being fraction bits. The same applies in the block where I left off at the end of the previous video. This block takes a rolling average of the last 16 lane widths, which are 12-bit integers. But Xilinx's automatic propagation takes the safe approach and provides as many bits as it would possibly need when dividing by 16, which is 32 bits, with 1 bit being a sign bit, and 18 fraction bits. Knowing the design, I know that it's going to be a positive number, so it can be unsigned, and I don't need any fraction bits. So I can just specify that it be unsigned 12 bits. As this and its left lane counterpart propagate forward into a multiplier, the 32-bit input would require two DSP slices, so using smaller data types can potentially save some key resources. Again, Fixed Point Designer can take care of all of this for you, but it helps to know what the design is doing. After verifying that it still generates results within my accuracy tolerance, I can then generate HDL. The easiest way to get started is with the Hdl Workflow Advisor, which walks you through all the steps. I'm just going to focus on a couple key steps. I'm going to target a Xilinx Zynq device, and I want to map my left and right lane outputs to registers that the software running on the ARM can read. So I choose IP core generation, and that lets me do this mapping in the next step. The pixels and control signals are coming in from an external memory buffer, and the AXI stream for video protocol is built right in for that. And then the outputs here are all talking to the software running on the ARM, so those will get mapped to AXI Lite registers. Now, skipping ahead a bit, I want to make sure all these reports are generated so I can see how well it's mapping to my device. There are advanced options to customize the generated code and optimization options, but all the defaults are good starting points, so I can just generate code. And this takes a minute or so, and it brings up the reports. The first thing I usually look at is the high-level resource usage report and compare it to the resources on my device's datasheet to make sure it all fits. Often, first things to look at are multiplier resource usage because DSP slices are precious resources, and RAM usage for similar reasons. Both of those would typically be addressed by making design or optimization trade-offs. The critical path estimation tells you how long your slowest path is, which is the gating factor in how fast a clock frequency you can use. In this case, it's not a big challenge. Each second, I want to process 30 frames of pixels with blanking intervals, which comes out to 12.6 MHz, which isn't very challenging. That clock period is about 79 nanoseconds. For more challenging clock periods, if I need to, I can insert extra pipeline stages to break long paths in the design, or let Hdl Coder do it automatically. Finally, the IP core generation report will give you detailed instructions on integrating the core into your system-on-chip device and the downstream implementation tools. This video series covered a lot of ground at a high level in order to give you an idea as to what it takes to implement a video processing subsystem in hardware. It may sound like a lot of work, but this workflow has proven over and over to be more productive than handwriting code in traditional workflows. You can find more detailed information on all of these steps in the product documentation, and a great place to start are the examples, such as this lane detection example, since they walk you through practical applications in real scenarios.